Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf online, sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, gray pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee. They go over every vehicle. Terrific service department that backs it up every step of the way. It's Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf online at sunburymotors.com. Time now for Tuesdays with Neil. We welcome in the outstanding Neal Coolong. Sir, always a pleasure.
And always the pleasure is mine. Thanks for having me.
Okay, America's Great Mystery Team moves on as they continue the third and final game of this homestand, and they've got Jordan Love and the Green Bay Packers. It's a team that defies explanation in many ways, but let's start with this part. What does Johnson mean to the offense when he is a part of the mix to help out Kenny Pickett?
Johnson overall is their best receiver. It's not even particularly close. I mean, that's probably the biggest understatement you'll hear. When I say that, I don't mean, you know, highlight reel, YouTubeable catches on the sideline. I mean actually playing the position. As far as his route running, his balance, hands have been a question with him overall. But you're looking at a tactician of getting open. Very few receivers, if any, are able to earn as much separation in the mid-range as Deontay Johnson is. And that's critically important for an offense that isn't attacking down the field successfully all that often and needs a guy to make up for something of a lack of a running game, which we've seen often throughout the year. In fact, I'd say it's pretty remarkable that they had any offensive success in the time that Johnson was out. But Johnson coming back and the offense getting used to him, kind of building up together is only going to make them stronger. And he's a player they absolutely need to step up and be a 13, 14 target guy and make the most out of every opportunity that he gets. It's not going to be great. We've seen a quarterback that hasn't been consistently accurate. I'm not suggesting he's going to be a 150-yard a game guy, but when they need plays made in the passing game, it's probably going to be Johnson getting the target, and he's going to have to step up and make the most out of that.
Amazing in all of this, sometimes you will see teams that play great defense, and the Steelers do, they play great defense, and they at least have a running game to back it up, maybe eat a little bit of clock and so forth. This team averages 3.7 yards a carry, Neil. 3.7. How much of it is the running backs, and how much of it is initial contact being right around the line of scrimmage?
It's both, and I think most people answer this question based on which unit they like more, which tends to be the running back. So you constantly blame the offensive line. Just bottom line, you're not talking about the 1984 Redskins running game here. You know, this is not a high-level offense in any way, shape, or form. The running backs pretty consistently miss holes that they have. They're not making the most out of the opportunities that they're getting. And the offensive line does not consistently produce at least a stalemate at the line of scrimmage, let alone winning the line of scrimmage and pushing it back and giving the running back an opportunity to accelerate and find a spot to run. Both of these things are failing pretty consistently. And most importantly, it's failing throughout multiple schemes. They're not a great inside zone running team, which is what kind of picked them up last year and helped them, you know, accelerate to that, you know, kind of probably mediocre level that they achieved by the end of last season. They're not running gap particularly well. They're not running combos well at all. There are a lot of things that are going wrong throughout all phases of it. And keep in mind, too, when we talk about run blocking, it is not just on your offensive line. Tight ends as well. And to me, I think that has been maybe the biggest issue They're not getting very good play out of their tight ends at all. That's probably because the veteran, the guy that was probably not going to come off the field ever, Pat Freiermuth, has been out. I mean, he got hurt early in week one. I don't think he's played more than 10 snaps this year healthy. So that's hurting them in terms of outside zone, stretch. They're not able to run those concepts due to the lack of experience they have blocking up front. Connor Hayward is not a physically imposing tight end. He's going to have a tougher time in line blocking to the strength. Jordan, I don't know why I keep doing that. Darnell Washington is having he's having some moments, but he's a young blocker. He's going to get better. He's going to improve over time, but he's going to take some lumps while he's out there. You're seeing that snap to snap right now. I don't even remember the third one's name. Rodney Williams is that guy that they're bringing up for practice squad duty, from the practice squad for special teams duty. He's getting in on offensive snaps now. I think that's how shallow it seems their tight ends have been producing for the offense overall. These are tough things to overcome as an entire running game. We've seen flashes of it. There have been times they've put stuff together and looked pretty good. I think it's the arrow is pointed up. If they wish to keep Broderick Jones on the right side, have Dan Moore, who's, I thought, played pretty well since he's gotten injured, that's a positive boost for them. I think Jones played really well, I thought, at right tackle, considering the circumstance. The arrow is definitely on the rise, and it's something in which they can use to get better as the season goes on. But if they're going to go from 3.7 to, 4.2 between now and the end of the season, a lot of things are going to need to change. I'm not sure if they're going to be able to do that.
Yet you have a place kicker in Chris Boswell who is 14 for 14 under 60 yards. I didn't say under 50. And Senator 40, he's 14 of 14 under 60 yards. What does that at least do to the decision-making process for Mike Tomlin as to how he plays this chess game with this team?
Well, I think Tomlin showed they got backed up 5 yards and he had Boswell kick. I think it was 60 at Hines, and understandably he missed by a few. This is the Boswell we've gotten to know. I think at this point, most teams can probably say the best kicker in franchise history is playing for them or played for them within the last 5-7 years. But Boswell has earned that distinction through the consistency at home. And when you see a 3-game stretch at home, oftentimes, I mean, this is what I think, NFL teams enjoy comfort. The longer that they stay stationary, they have their exact routine down, they're comfortable, the better they're going to look versus their opponent that's traveling in from out of town. They're lacking that type of routine. You expect them to get better, but then you're looking at your kicker. It's maybe the hardest stadium in the NFL to kick in. It's consistently on those lines. We see opponents missing kicks in Heinz Field all the time, unless his name's Justin Tucker. Boswell is still consistent even at Heinz Field. I think that's a pretty remarkable accomplishment in comparison to his peers. Tomlin is not afraid to have Boswell attempt something in which he's probably barely clear the crossbar. In other words, he's not afraid to put him out there at 57. I'm not sure if that's whatever cliche you want to use. He has faith in his defense. He has faith in the kicker. It's a bomb, whatever it is, and he's not afraid to do it. And for a team that is probably going to have to kick a lot of field goals, make a lot of field goals to be competitive in a lot of their games, I think the one thing Tomlin can say, there's a better chance of this going our way than most other things that we could do right now. So in that, he should have confidence in Boswell. Boswell's earned that. As the weather gets worse, you hope that it continues, and Boswell has shown that he can still do that despite the conditions. But it'd be a lot better if they could just, convert 4th and 5, 4th and 6 a little bit more consistently, or had a prayer of even doing that in an even situation. If they're 35 and it's 4th and 3, if it was a situation in which they felt confident that they could get those 3 yards and they went for it and converted that, I think they'd be better off. But having the kicker that can hit for 52-plus on a bad field in a tough kicking stadium is definitely a huge advantage.
T.J. Watt has 22 tackles this season. 9.5 of them are sacks. What do you think of when you hear that number and then also match it up with the visual?
You know, it's funny that you asked that. I was thinking that during the Titans game. You really didn't hear from him or see him, and a large part of that was they didn't run at him at all. You know, whether or not he's clear enough and the running back is slow enough to the hole for Watt to be able to get down the entire line and make a play, you know, that's something else. But they're not even trying to challenge him in a lot of cases. We saw a lot of the same sort of obstacle course blocking teams have done against him. They're challenging him with the tackle up front. They're putting somebody right behind the tackle to chip him whenever he comes off of the tackle. That's slowing him down a bit. That's making him work even harder than he normally works. You know, I think that's limited his production a little bit, but the impact that he makes is always going to be beyond the basic scorebook. If you look at hurries, if you look at pressures, you see a little bit more clearly the impact that Watt can make. But at some point, and I think we're in this now, teams are just going to flat out stay away from him, just simply because what's the point? And we talked about this a couple weeks ago. The amount of big plays he makes, especially late in games, is unparalleled. You just don't see that. The edge rusher taking over a fourth quarter, much like a Steelers quarterback, except he plays for the three quarters before that too. It's for a defensive player to be able to do that. You don't see it anywhere else. But now it's like, you know what? Just never mind. Forget it. You want to have that side? That's fine. We can play toe-to-toe with this team because they don't have any offense at all. At some point, we can break through. I don't feel confident that, even if Kenny Pickett has done this a few times, I don't feel fully confident over a second half they're going to have more opportunities than we are. Stay away from Watt. Don't let him make plays on the ball down the field. Don't let him make plays on the ball in the backfield. Just do what you can to not have the ball near him. It seems like that strategy is building. We'll see what Green Bay does with him. Different team, obviously, than Tennessee. Overall, it's probably a reasonable strategy, all things considered, especially if Minka Fitzpatrick's not on the field. Just try to limit their defensive playmakers as much as you can, and your offense is eventually going to break through. Pittsburgh's offense, though, another story. You're probably going to get more opportunities in the game than they will.
A few years ago, Green Bay drafted Jordan Love, number one, out of Utah State with the idea he would be in this position today. He's there now. When you have had the moments to observe Green Bay, what have you thought about him as a starting quarterback?
Mediocre. There's some nice physical tools to him. I think he's a really nice athlete.
Yeah.
He's had a lot of time to learn, to absorb. And you get into this kind of chicken versus the egg argument of should he sit or should he play? Should he get the experience? He's had plenty of time in the rooms. You know, he's learned. It doesn't seem to reflect as well on the field. He got off to a nice start. You thought you saw some good things from him right away. It seems like teams got that film and studied it and broke it down. He hasn't been able to counterpunch to that yet. That's a problem. Offensively, that's a problem. I don't know whether it's entirely on your quarterback versus your offense in general. It's not a good offensive team. I don't think anybody expected it to be. They're going to struggle, but he's not making them any better either. He's really kind of down at the same level as the rest of them. You know, if he goes off for 350 and four touchdowns, I'm sure I'll say something different. But I don't think he's capable of doing that right now against a good defense in the NFL. It seems to me mental mistakes. I don't think it's so much of a physical concern. He's got a nice arm. He's got really nice feet. The ball doesn't seem to go often where he wants it to go. He's not particularly accurate. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of the knock on him coming out of college. You know, there's some fundamental mechanical issues that he has. I don't see that those have really been fixed. He's had plenty of time to work on that. So if he's at his ceiling, it wouldn't surprise me. I don't know how much better he'd be able to get. And you're seeing the results week in and week out. It's not particularly good.
Okay, so I'll give you a funny story. They play on Thursday night against Detroit. As you know, Detroit really won the game handily. And Sean Clifford is sitting on the bench. And they start chanting. And Sean is the one, he told Jack Ham and me the story, because Penn State played at Northwestern on that Saturday, so he came down from Green Bay to see his brother Liam play. And he's telling us, I'm sitting on the bench, they're chanting, we want Clifford, we want Clifford. He said, I started to smile. He said, then I realized all those times that in Beaver Stadium they were chanting, we want Levis, we want Aller. He says, and at that point I told Jordan, hey, you're okay, don't worry about it.
It's nice to be on the other side of that. The quarterback's the most popular guy in town. You know, yeah. If you're not hearing it, it means you're not starting. So,
yeah,
it'd be interesting if they would make a move. Season, I don't think there's much they can do. But in the off season, I wouldn't be surprised if they went looking.
Yeah,
he's just not there. And there's been a lot of time that he's got. I get that he doesn't have a whole lot of games, but. Again, the same people that will say, well, he hasn't played enough yet are the ones that said, he's okay, he's learning, he's going to be good when he comes in because he has all this experience. All this validates is that there was a reason they let Aaron Rodgers hold him hostage for as long as they did.
Yeah.
Not just that it's Aaron Rodgers, it's that they knew Jordan Love isn't worth it. But at the end of the day, if you really want to go back to this, it's not the fairest comparison, but they didn't put up a whole lot of resistance for Favre leaving town because they knew what they had in Rodgers. Right. If they knew that they had something in Love, a lot of the Aaron Rodgers stuff wouldn't have happened. Okay, it's as simple as that. You want to move on to the less expensive younger guy as quickly as possible. Doesn't matter who they are. That's the economic reality of the NFL. Jordan Love, though, is not the guy that you want starting for your team next year the way that it looks today. Give him a chance. You know, he's probably going to start for the rest of the season, barring injury, and no one's rooting for that. But I don't think that's a long-term solution there. They're going to need to figure something out, and their record might put them in line to be able to make a move there. Depth issues on that team, cap issues on that team, they're in trouble. It might take them a couple of years to get out of this.
Well, I just feel like at this particular time, you know, the Steelers beat Tennessee on the Thursday night, had extra time. Green Bay, to me, is the perfect team to come in and play them right now.
Yeah, oddly enough, I was talking to a guy in town here I know is a big Packers fan. I was joking with him. We're enemies this week. And he kind of looked at me like, what are you talking about? Like, Steelers-Packers on Sunday. Oh, yeah. He completely checked out. Doesn't care at all. He's like a diehard Packers fan. Yeah. Maybe some of that's the clocks changing and the overall wonderful vibe you get in Minnesota in November, but it's really hard for Green Bay to go on the road and win a game right now. They're really not a very good team. And where Pittsburgh is, this is one of those games that just miraculously pop up on their schedule at the perfect time. They really need to put this together. They don't have a terrible schedule, but it's really hot and cold. And if they win the games they should win for the rest of the year, and there are some clunkers on there, including Green Bay, Indianapolis, if they win the rest of the way, I think they're 10-7. And that's assuming that they lose twice to Cincinnati, again to Baltimore, once to Baltimore, and then once to Cleveland, and whoever it may be. I guess New England is a clunker now as well. But for them, they very well could finish like 100 minus 100 in point differential and win 10 games.
Right.
And Green Bay fits that narrative so perfectly well, because it's like you don't get blown out by anybody except for week one, but you lose enough and you're so underwhelming in your victories. Like, how did this even happen? It's the ultimate Mike Tomlin team now, you know, with the amount of times that he spends talking about style points and how that doesn't matter. The winning is the only thing that matters. Like, that is the reality for the Steelers.
Yeah, that's right.
It really doesn't make a difference how they do it. The only thing this team does well consistently is win games, and how that happens is beyond me.
I'm taken aback by it. I mean, every game that they play, and it's over, I sit back and say, how the heck did that happen? I rarely have seen anything like this.
It's really an every week thing. I was joking, and I remember talking about this back in, this is December of 21, when they beat Tennessee in Pittsburgh, which at the time, I said this is perhaps the dumbest Steelers win I've ever seen.
Yeah.
They had no business winning that game. I'd probably put five of them since then on that level. Pretty close.
Yeah.
Two of them this year. The fact that it continues to happen, it's become their signature. And I've never seen a team like this in the NFL. It doesn't make any sense. But it just kind of seems like all the cliches are, figuratively true. They cut the eyelids off. They're not blinking. They're not afraid of, whatever the situation is. It's just the reality is they find a way to drag a team down into the muck with them, and they could win down there. For the team to avoid the huge mistakes that the defense will force upon them in the second half, to make all of their field goals, to run the ball consistently, to catch everything that's thrown their way. I know that sounds like basic football, but those things just stop happening against the Steelers for their opponents, particularly when they're playing at home nowadays. Ask Baltimore. I was joking around this week that John Harbaugh wakes up in the middle of the night with phantom Kenny Pickett flying over his head in cold sweats, wondering all the games that they lost because of really just no reason. They've lost, five or six to the Steelers, I think, now?
Yeah.
And they should have won every one of those games.
Yeah,
just, it's ridiculous. It doesn't make any sense. And I've been saying for at least a year and a half, the other shoe's going to fall eventually, but it hasn't. And I can keep saying it. Eventually, I'm going to be right. But, the joke's on me ultimately, because this team has grossly overachieved over the life, really, since Ben's elbow snapped back in 2019. They've been a bad offensive team that's gotten opportunistic defensive efforts in more games than not. And somehow that's compiled, nine, 10-win seasons for them. It's beyond me to explain how it's going to continue. I just feel like it will.
Always a pleasure, even when we're not quite sure.
Absolutely. We'll talk about the next crazy win next week.
Thanks, Neal. Neal Coolong. We'll come back with more in a moment, brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Elmo's Wharf, and online, sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory, Sunbury Motors guarantee. Terrific service department, routine, difficult. They handle it all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummels Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. So, Penn State, Michigan, Saturday. And James talked yesterday in his press conference about the patience needed. And you have to have some patience. You have to be patient and then, in the moment, pick the spot to be aggressive. And you can do that if you stay on schedule. And it's the same thing with Michigan. Michigan has been staying on schedule. That's been important for them. When they get to third down, they've been in that third and manageable area, and that's why they are at 56% this season. 56% on third down. Because they're in that third and manageable. And uh, And that's what, you know, has allowed them to be efficient offensively. And that's how you get to be 56%. You get those third and manageables, those third and less than fours. And now you have this game where your job defensively is to put them in the uncomfortable position of third and five or better, third and nine, third and 12, if it's possible. Get them off schedule. Conversely, your offense needs to stay on schedule. That's where the patience comes in. You can be patient offensively if you have third and manageables, where you're doing a good job on first and second down to make it happen. Tommy Doman's a good punter. Ryan Thompson's a good punter. Plays kicking game. They have the kid from Louisville, Turner, who transferred in. He's been good. I mean, that hasn't been called upon to make a really big kick yet, but he's good. And Alex Falcons has been good. And something that could be critical in this game is the ability of a Daquan Hardy to break a punt return. Maybe he doesn't take it all the way back, but he sets up the offense to do something from point-blank range. But a guy like that could be absolutely critical to your ability to flip the field and set you up offensively. So there's all these little things that go into it. And all that aside, we all know what the overriding story is all week. And the key is for Penn State is to go out on the practice field tonight and just get ready. Key for Penn State is to go out tomorrow night, just get ready. Just, you know what? Do everything you can to shut out the outside noise, including what is going on with whatever scandal there happens to be. And just take care of your business. Somehow, just leave it in such a way where you're just working on what you need to work on. The other stuff you have no control over, so there's no even need on your part to even worry about it, think about it. Oh, is it an intriguing story? Sure. It's intriguing. It has espionage. Has a that feel of espionage, has that feel of a paper trail, has that feel of a video trail. I mean, it's all these little intriguing twists and turns, and then something new seems to come out every day. But the game is Saturday. You're going to play. And you go out and just get your job done. And the old Bill Belichick, and he's right. Do your job. Okay? What happens on Saturday, you just take care of your own business. You can set up Saturday by what you do today, what you do tomorrow, your walkthrough on Thursday, fast Friday, get ready. I also think there is the idea, which I find intriguing, and people have not talked about it. I know a lot of people have talked about what happened to Penn State against Ohio State, and I completely understand that. And the key in that game, if you really want to boil it down to be simple, is going 1-for-16 on third down. We talked about the ability to have manageable third downs. Even when they had third and less than four, they were 0-6. And they were 1-for-10 on third and five or better. But maybe along the way, everybody on the football team learned a lesson about playing in that game that you can now apply to this game. And that's something that hasn't really been talked about. The ability to learn from the first summer. I said, yeah, we approached it this way. You know what? We can have a better approach. Right? As players. As whatever. You know? And just go out and have fun with this thing and go attack it. You're playing at home. Have fun. You know, and this is a crazy thing about it. Big game, serious game, the whole thing. Go out and have fun. Go out and have fun. Just lay it out there and have fun. And all the hard work is being done now. All the hard work is going to come up here in 2 hours. Yeah. All the hard work is going to be for a couple of hours tomorrow. Looking at the tape, the video, going through the meetings, then practicing, all the hard work. And you get to Saturday, let it all hang out and have fun. Get out there with your crowd and just play hard and enjoy it. I know it sounds simple, but then again, I'm a simple guy. So, Troy Aikman last night had, when I finally got home from the basketball game, said last night on the Chargers-Jets game on Monday Night Football, and Troy Aikman's really good, by the way. He and Joe Buck are tremendous. For as good as this group is, for them not to get a chance to do something really special with this team because an offense can't score a touchdown, pretty maddening, because the defense for the Jets is terrific. When you evaluate Zach Wilson and the things where he's got to be better, this is it. First throw of the game, and this is a layup. You've got to hit these. All right? You have to hit these layups. It's an easy completion. And he airmails it. He just misses entirely too many of these easy throws from an NFL quarterback. Hey, that's a fact. Is he being personal about it? No, he's talking about from a quarterback's point of view. So interesting. He was good. I didn't get a chance to ask Neal about Josh Dobbs going to the Vikings. Didn't practice, you know, did nothing in practice. Just kind of sat and said, okay, how's this thing work? Then it goes out and wins the game. Other than that, not bad. Not bad at all. LSU in women's basketball lost last night to Colorado, the defending national champions. But it's opening night. Mike Rhodes told his team on Sunday, 180 teams win, 180 lose on opening night. He says, I need to be on the side where the 180 wins. Well, they were. They won last night and defeated Delaware State 79-45. I know a tough one for Bucknell last night is Delaware 178-57. They've got Niagara on the road, and that will be Saturday at 7 o'clock. Looking for John's first win as the head coach of Bucknell. John's going to do and is doing a terrific job. They could not have made a better hire there. I have nothing but great things to say about John. I think he's a quality guy, quality coach. And it was just a tough one to open up with last night. But it is basketball season, and yes, James Madison beat Michigan State last night, and North Carolina struggled with Radford. Finally won, but they struggled with them for a period of time. So, There you have it. I mean, we talked about various areas of the Michigan game. And breaking the game down is not going to happen much this week because of what is going on at Michigan. And I don't blame you, because what's happening in Michigan is intriguing with a lot of twists and turns in the story. Okay. I mean, I understand that completely. We've talked about it enough. Haven't said what I would do with it. I prefer at this moment to stay out of it till I know more. But I have read to you all the stuff that's been going on with it to this point. And Penn State basketball, by the way, did win its game last night, as I mentioned earlier. The only negative to me was the turnover part. In the turnover part, was just strange. Now, some of the second half turnover, both teams had like a lot of turnovers in the first half. The second half turnover thing backed off some, but then in the last 5 or 6 minutes, Penn State had turnovers. But, and I said this to Mike Rhodes afterward, just chit-chatting on the floor, I said, I feel like some of those turnovers in the last 5 or 6 minutes were your players trying to set up teammates for baskets to get him in the scoring column. He goes, yeah, it was. But that doesn't explain the first half. Sometimes played a little too fast, a little bit out of control, maybe got too casual in a pass, but they got away with it. They won the game. And the key is, you know, you win the game, thus you get away with it, which is great. So now you can sit down with them on film, or tomorrow, it'll be, they're not practicing today. Tomorrow on film before practice, and say, hey, here you go. This is what we need to clean up. And they've got Lehigh at 7:30 on Friday night. So if you're coming in for the Michigan game, there's a basketball game in the Jordan Center Friday night at 7:30. We'll take a break, wrap it up in a moment. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors, here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Attention all military service personnel. Ultimate Express Car Wash in Seals Grill, Danville, and Williamsport wants to thank you for your service this Saturday, November 11th from 7:30 till 6 with a free car wash. All veterans and active duty military will get their best exterior wash free. Offer valid on Saturday, November 11th only, rain or shine. Ultimate Express is proud to be a Grace for Vets participant. Learn more at graceforvets.org. So vets and active duty personnel, they'll see you at Ultimate Express Car Wash on Route 11 Seals Grove, on Route 11 in Danville, and Washington Boulevard, Williamsport.
My ride smells just right, just right, just right, just right.
I gotta try that Febreze car.
Just right, just right, just right, just right. La 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 la. Picked up for 40 days of consistent scent. All over Febreze car clips right on your vent. You know my car's my happy place. Keep a smile on my face. When it smells just right, just right, just right. Breathe happy Febreze. La 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 la.
By the way, Bucknell goes to the Plestra to play Penn tomorrow night. Then it's at Niagara. Doug texted me to make sure I knew that, and I appreciate that, Doug. So they're at the Plestra tomorrow as John goes home, although Bucknell's is home. So that's Penn at the Plestra, then Niagara. All right. John Oran, Sports Business Journal, Diamond Sports Group, reaching a one-year deal with the NBA that guarantees that the Bally Sports Regional Sports Networks will continue to carry NBA games to the end of the season. This is all part of the bankruptcy court filing. Court needs to okay this. So now the NBA will have a little more flexibility as Diamond tries to navigate through the bankruptcy. And they could keep some of it. Diamond or the NBA could keep it. The NHL is maybe a few weeks away from cutting a similar deal. They say Diamond's happy with it. They're trying to get out of bankruptcy. Diamond Sports spokesperson said, quote, our newly signed agreements with the NBA, Comcast, and our creditors reflect significant progress on Diamond's path forward. Upon court approval, these agreements will enable Diamond to continue delivering live game broadcasts to fans through the 23-24 NBA, NHL, and Major League Baseball seasons. So Diamond has been broadcasting NBA and NHL games, will continue to do so while the court considers our motions and while discussions with the NHL finalize with respect to their own new deal. Now, after the season, the NBA can reclaim the rights to the 15 teams. At the same time, the teams can work out new deals with Diamond if they wish. So, the regional sports network thing was thought to be one of the saviors for sports on the local level. And now you have all of these issues, big financial issues. You're wondering with everything in sports right now, with the big money available. And some parts are positive. Let's start with Amazon, the streaming. Amazon last year said they could get 12 million households to stream Thursday Night Football. They got instead an average of 9.7. You know what it is today? This season, it's 12.7 million. They're past that goal. They're up 25% over last year. Better games. And I'll say this. Whatever they're doing with the streaming part of it, last year I would stream games, especially the first, four or five, and I'd get the dreaded circle, and I'd have to wait, and I'd get the dreaded circle. I haven't had the dreaded circle one time all season watching an Amazon Prime game this year. I mean, zero. Not once has it circled and paused on the stream. I mean, now maybe you have a different experience. I don't know, but I haven't. It's been my experience this year with Amazon Prime has been great. The games have been better. Big plus. And they're up 25% over last year. Tremendous. And as for the NFL this week, what is the Thursday game? Thursday game this week is... Mertzi will be watching. But the Carolina Panthers and the Chicago Bears. I may see a little bit of that, although I think Louisville's playing in college football on Thursday night. And Louisville's played pretty well. I think Thursday night. Yeah, Louisville, Virginia. Virginia, of course, struggling at 2-7. And Louisville's 8-1. That one loss was to Pitt after Louisville had beat Notre Dame. It's almost inexplicable, really. Miami's got Florida State. This is the primetime game this week. Ole Miss, Georgia. That should be a heck of a game. West Virginia, Oklahoma is interesting. That's on Fox. And Michigan State, Ohio State, not intriguing. Texas, TCU, not intriguing. LSU, Florida, eh. USC, Oregon's the 10:30 game. I find that to be somewhat intriguing, although there's no way in the planet USC can stop Oregon's offense. But they did remove Alex Grinch as the defensive coordinator. I will say this, he's not the one executing the defenses. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Bill Bender's Sporting News tomorrow. Sean Hannity next after the news here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.